December 7th, 1970. The Awami League, a party based in East Pakistan, has just achieved an astounding victory in the Pakistani elections. From a position of power, the party leader meets with the president and other party leaders to form the first democratic government in the country's history. But things will not go smoothly at all. Just 1 year later, in December 71, East Pakistan will be an independent state. And at what price? A brutal war that left millions dead and displaced. So how did this escalation happen? How could a successful election result lead to such a massive catastrophe? This is the story of Pakistan's disturbing past. A story of a forgotten genocide that still awaits to be recognized. United Pakistan. Pakistan's independence from the British Empire was a result of a long struggle, driven by both nationalist and religious motivations. This struggle opposed not only British colonial rule, but also Indian Hindu nationalism. In August 1947, the independent state of Pakistan was finally formed, consisting of two geographically distinct parts: West Pakistan, the territory that is modern-day Pakistan, and East Pakistan, located in the region of East Bengal, a Muslim-majority area that remained part of Pakistan until 1971, when it became the independent nation of Bangladesh. East Pakistan was not originally a central part of the initial vision for Pakistan's independence, which had primarily focused on the Muslim-majority areas in the West. The only significant connection between the two regions was their shared religion, which seemed sufficient at first. For over two decades, this bond held the two regions together, suggesting a willingness to cooperate despite their differences. However, tensions were present from the beginning, and it only took a spark to turn them into a full-scale crisis. One early sign of this divide can be found in the very name, Pakistan. The term is an acronym representing the western regions of British India, with no reference to Bengal. This omission, though symbolic, reflected the reality of East Pakistan's marginalization in the new state. The political and administrative centers of Pakistan, first in Karachi and then Rawalpindi, and later Islamabad, were firmly in the West. The government initially refused to recognize Bengali as an official language alongside Urdu, although East Pakistan had a larger population. The military, political, and administrative establishment was also dominated by West Pakistan. By the mid-1950s, of 741 top civil servants, only 51 were Bengali. In the military, in 1955, there was only one Bengali brigadier, one colonel, and two lieutenant colonels out of 308 of equivalent or higher rank. As late as 1963, only 5% of the officer corps of the Pakistani army and 7% of the other ranks were Bengali. This will play a significant role in the unfolding story. These, along with historical prejudices, such as the belief that Bengalis, having converted to Islam later, were lesser Muslims, fueled growing suspicion and hostility. Still, none of this can explain the horrific events that happened in 1971, when on the 25th of March, the Pakistan Army surprisingly launched Operation Searchlight. Operation Searchlight. East Pakistan, 25th of March, 2330. The Pakistani Army, 12,000 strong with air, artillery, and tanks, launches premeditated attacks across the entire province. The main focus is Dhaka, the capital, where the army arrests Mujibur Rahman, leader of the dominant party, the Awami League, and transfers him to a jail in West Pakistan. Just before being arrested, Mujib declares the independence of the region as Bangladesh and calls the Pakistani Bengalis to fight. Discussions for independence have long been in the air. Their center is Dhaka University, a hub of intellectual support for East Pakistan's secession and home to active student organizations. A professor, Rafiqul Islam, later recalls, "I don't have the words to express the bestiality and barbarity that was perpetuated on the Dhaka University area. What transpired there, I saw with my own eyes, raging infernos everywhere. The slum was burning, the cars parked around the residences were burning. The heaped bodies of the dead from the slum were also set on fire near the Nilket Railgate petrol pump. The sound of shells bursting and guns firing, the smoke and fire, the smell of gunpowder and the stench of the burning corpses, all transformed the area into a fiery hell. Every so often, our building was being peppered with bullets. In the midst of this, we, our families, the students, and bearers from the halls, the slum dwellers, had given up all hope for life. And were waiting for the hour of death. Casualties can only be estimated. Around 200 students and professors are killed. In a separate dormitory assault, Pakistani forces execute 34 non-Muslim students, lining them up, shooting them, and dumping the bodies into a mass grave. Chaos grips Dhaka as strategic locations fall under military control. The Awami League members are arrested. The old Dhaka district, a bustling area filled with shops and homes, a stronghold of the Awami League, is set ablaze. 700 people are burned alive. Particularly brutal are the attacks on Hindus, seen as supporters of the Awami League and potential Indian sympathizers. The attacks from the military continue, with as many as 7,000 civilians killed in just the first day. Simultaneously, coordinated assaults take place across the province. The military's objective is to crush resistance within a month and restore order under the regime in Islamabad. Yet by the end of March, large swathes of territory remain in the hands of locals. The army controls Dhaka and key cities, but resistance continues in rural areas. The few East Pakistani soldiers mutiny, refusing to attack their own people. Fleeing persecution, many cross into India, where the seeds of a counterattack begin to form. But how did this all start? Why did a country fall so suddenly to this unimaginable scale of violence? Why? To understand the events that led to 1971, we need to look back a few months earlier to December 1970. Yahya Khan, the country's president, has taken power in 1969 with the promise of elections and a new constitution. The elections were scheduled for the 7th of December 1970, and neither the military nor political elites anticipated any radical shift. Yet, tensions were rising. In West Pakistan, the Pakistan People's Party, PPP, led by Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, positioned itself as the liberator from dictatorship, advocating for socialist policies. In East Pakistan, the key issue wasn't class, but national identity and autonomy. The Awami League, led by Sheikh Mujib, campaigned on a six-point platform demanding significant autonomy for East Pakistan, including control over its own economy and currency, addressing specifically the disparities in economic distribution between East and West. These demands were rejected by Islamabad, but resonated deeply with Bengalis. Their frustrations peaked after a devastating typhoon in November, which left hundreds of thousands dead. The Pakistani government's slow and inadequate response only fueled the belief that East Pakistan was treated as second class. Despite being more populous and a key producer of jute, a vital export crop, the East saw most of the national budget flowing to the West and not even used to protect them from such a disaster. After the election results were announced, everyone was shocked. In the West, the People's Party had secured 83 out of 138 seats in the new parliament, a result that they could be happy about. But in East Pakistan, something unthinkable had happened. The Awami League got an outstanding 160 out of 162 seats. In a 300-seat parliament, this meant the Awami League had the majority needed to form the national government. The West Pakistani establishment was stunned and refused to accept the new situation. Bhutto declared that the Awami League couldn't govern alone and demanded a coalition. President Yahya Khan visited Dhaka to negotiate with Mujib, but talks stalled over East Pakistan's push for autonomy. When negotiations failed, the first parliamentary session set for March 3rd was postponed. The Bengalis and the Awami League sensed something was amiss. Their party had just won a free election, yet West Pakistan was once again blatantly denying their rights. On March 7th, Mujib called for a general strike, bringing the country to a standstill, and tensions soared. Bengali citizens were ready to resist, while violent attacks on political opponents, especially the Biharis, a Muslim group culturally aligned with West Pakistan, intensified. By the time President Yahya Khan visited Dhaka on March 18th, the situation was nearly out of control and the military had already been briefed to intervene if negotiations failed. The main military's objectives were, 1, to treat all Awami League supporters as rebels and capture their leaders, and 2, to disarm all East Pakistani military and police forces. On March 25th, as soon as the president returned to Karachi with no deal in sight, the army launched an invasion of East Pakistan. The justification was the killing of thousands of Biharis in the province. A selective genocide? It's May 1971. Operation Searchlight has ended, and the Pakistani leadership is celebrating what they proclaim as a major success. The threat, they believe, is extinguished. Pakistan Army controls all major cities and Mujib has been arrested. But reality tells a different story. Mujib's proclamation of an independent Bangladesh just over a month earlier has sparked a national awakening. Now many Bengalis are no longer fighting just to survive. They're fighting for independence. The violence unleashed by the Pakistani army only fuels this determination, as their brutal actions against their own citizens ignite national and international outrage. As the army crushes poorly armed villagers, allegations of genocide start to spread, both in Pakistan and abroad. Most notably in India and the US, Pakistan's key ally. On May 25th, the US consul in Dhaka cables Washington, "Evidence of systematic persecution of the Hindu population is too detailed and too massive to ignore. The officers and men of the army are behaving as if they have been given carte blanche in East Pakistan." The scale of the operation shocks observers, with some likening it to the most incredible, calculated thing since the days of the Nazis in Poland. The comparison is chilling. Hindus are particularly targeted, victims of long-standing animosities now given brutal expression. Many times they are separated from the rest of the captured to be executed. On March 26th, the second day of the operation, the army kills 212 Bengali Hindus in the Shankari Bazar area of Old Dhaka. On April 23rd, in collaboration with local paramilitary forces, the Razakars, the Pakistani army, slaughters more than 3,000 Hindus in Jathibanga in the northwest of the province. These people, attempting to flee to India to escape persecution, were spotted and captured. Forced to stand in lines, they were gunned down by machine fire. The worst massacre occurs in Chuknagar, a small town near Khulna on the western border with India. By May 20th, Operation Searchlight is already being hailed a success. But for Bengalis, life is unbearable. With food and resources running out, millions attempt to flee to India, creating a massive refugee route through Chuknagar. At 10 a.m., three units of the Pakistani army storm the town, encircling it to prevent anyone from escaping. They begin shooting indiscriminately. Men, women, and children who try to hide or flee are hunted down and executed at close range. The river runs red with the blood of the victims. Again, most of them are Hindus. Mass rape becomes rampant, with Hindu women bearing the brunt of the violence. Thousands are taken as war booty, with the encouragement of religious leaders and the knowledge of military officials. These women are tortured, raped, and in many cases killed. Some are forced into military brothels, where they will serve the army for the next 6 months. The horrific violence exposes deep-seated religious and racial hatred, with Hindus treated as subhuman, and the military operating with total impunity. And so, a routine military operation has just been transformed into an all-out war. India intervenes. War is the last thing India's Prime Minister Indira Gandhi wants on her border. But as the crisis unfolds, around 10 million disparate refugees flee to India, stretching the country's resources to the breaking point. Camps are quickly set up in West Bengal and Assam, providing shelter and aid. Yet the pressure grows. Inside the crisis, Gandhi also sees an opportunity. Indian and Pakistan relations have been strained since their simultaneous independence in 1947. Their last war in 1965 ended in a stalemate. It is an old saying that your enemy's enemy is your friend, and Bangladesh appears to be India's best friend, and in dire need too. Initially, New Delhi is cautious about the Bengali secession movement. There are concerns that West Bengal's nationalists could also push for secession, causing internal issues for India. Any careless intervention can backfire, and calls of support by Mujib in March are dismissed. But the crisis grows, and public opinion strongly supports Bangladesh, especially as reports of atrocities against Hindus surface. when high-ranking Awami League officials, including Tajuddin Ahmad, second in command after Mujib, cross into India seeking support, India finds itself drawn into the conflict, whether it wants it or not. On April 3, 1971, Tajuddin meets with Gandhi. The speed at which the meeting is organized clearly shows that India is deeply engaged in the matter. Gandhi agrees to provide arms, military advisors, and logistical support to the emerging Bangladesh army, but she withholds formal recognition of Bangladesh to avoid diplomatic fallout. In the following weeks, Tajuddin announces the formation of the new government and the Mukti Bahini, the new state's military force. Initially overpowered by the Pakistani army and unable to connect with the population in Bangladesh, the Mukti Bahini, with Indian assistance, will be transformed into a force to be reckoned with within the coming months. But this assistance is not a given. New Delhi is concerned for a variety of reasons. The huge influx of refugees has to be controlled, and if the Bangladeshi movement fails, then India will need open corridors with Pakistan to resolve this huge problem. The Awami League is also divided, with its leader Mujib imprisoned, while India is wary of rival powers like China intervening. It is Gandhi's strenuous diplomatic efforts, as well as Pakistan's actions and missteps, that help India navigate this impasse. On the 24th of May, 1971, Gandhi declares that Pakistan's problem has become India's problem, thus internationalizing the issue and calling on other powers to assist in its resolution. Her message carries a warning. If the world does not take heed, we shall be constrained to take all measures as may be necessary to ensure our own security. Gandhi's actions serve as a masterclass in navigating the complex labyrinths of international diplomacy. She first visits the Soviet Union at the end of September and successfully secures support from its leaders. Then at the beginning of November, she travels to Washington to meet with Nixon and appeals directly to the American public for their understanding, exposing Pakistan's atrocities. Her efforts push the U.S. government into the difficult decision to halt military aid to Pakistan. In a 1971 American poll, Gandhi is voted the most admired woman in the world. Meanwhile, atrocities by the Pakistani army intensify. Operation Searchlight's brutal crackdown in March 1971 marks the beginning, but the violence worsens throughout the year. Reports of mass killings, indiscriminate shelling, and sexual violence, particularly against Hindus, continue. Villages are razed, and women face horrific abuse, with estimates of 200,000 to 400,000 rapes and up to 3 million deaths. The international community is shocked by the scale of brutality. Pakistan, now isolated, makes a fatal mistake. On the 3rd of December, the Pakistani Air Force attempts a preemptive strike on India's Air Force, probably trying to imitate Israel's similar action against Egypt in 1967. But the attack fails and gives India the perfect excuse to release an all-out invasion of Pakistan. In less than 2 weeks, the Mukti Bahini and the Indian Army enter Dhaka, obliterating the Pakistani army and proclaiming the Bangladeshi independence. The day of independence for Bangladesh finally comes. Pakistan is forced to accept the outcome and recognize the new state, effectively losing over half its population. But the drama for the people is far from over.
When we got independence, it meant very little to me, because just a few days before, I was being violated, and then they were gone.
In the final days of the war, as defeat looms, Pakistani forces unleash a brutal last wave of genocidal violence. In a calculated attempt to cripple the future of Bangladesh, intellectuals, professors, and university students are systematically rounded up and executed in Dhaka. The infamous intellectual massacre of December 14, 1971, leaves the country's academic and cultural elite decimated, a deliberate effort to deprive the new nation of its intellectual foundation. At the same time, women, already victims throughout the conflict, endure an intensification of sexual violence. The Pakistani army and their local collaborators, the Razakars, carry out widespread rapes as a weapon of war, targeting Bengali women in a final, vengeful act of terror. Villages are destroyed and entire communities are wiped out as the violence reaches its peak. Everything speaks for genocide: the targeted killings of ethnic and religious minorities, the massive executions of the Bengali male population, and the rapes and kidnappings of women. all meet the conditions of the UN Genocide Convention. Aftermath. Bangladesh's independence did not bring the security and stability for which its people had fought so hard. In 1975, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, revered as the father of the nation, was assassinated in a military coup, marking a grim turn in the young nation's history and underscoring that the cycle of violence was far from over. The country, still reeling from the trauma of war, now faced internal strife and stability. Successive military regimes followed, each contributing to a legacy of authoritarian rule and political turbulence. Meanwhile, the victims of the 1971 massacres, those who had suffered unimaginable atrocities, were largely neglected. The new state, shattered by war and lacking resources and manpower, struggled to provide basic services to its citizens, let alone address the trauma endured by survivors. Many of the women who had been raped during the war were stigmatized and left without adequate support or recognition. And the displaced families and refugees faced immense hardships. Internationally, justice for the genocide remained elusive, despite overwhelming evidence, including footage of the atrocities, mass graves, and eyewitness accounts from survivors and foreign journalists. Pakistan has consistently denied the genocide. The global community, including the United States and the United Nations, has never officially recognized the events of 1971 as genocide, a fact that continues to haunt Bangladesh's collective memory. The lack of formal acknowledgement and accountability for Pakistan's actions perpetuates a lingering sense of injustice, leaving the wounds of the past unhealed and the tragedy of 1971 as a painful, unresolved chapter in both regional and international history.